So yes, I am Mathieu Journeau, the underlined name here, and it's a joint work with Antoine and Abdelraouf Wedjaout. So let's dive in. So you have on the top left here an example of the code snippet written in C, and it's performing the copy of the string that is pointed to by Q inside the string that is pointed to by P. Okay, so what we want to prove on this program is that there are no out-of-bound accesses. And in order to prove that, we are going to use classical techniques that try to track the length and the allocated size of the buffer we are working on. So here, those values are shown on the picture on the top left. And there is also some values for that describe the offsets of pointers P and pointers Q, which are OP and OQ. You can see that if we're able to prove some simple linear constraints on those variables that are written at the bottom here, then we are sure that there won't be any out-of-bound accesses. Therefore, we're going to try to track those four values. And in order to be able to scale on larger program, which manipulates a lot of strings, or a lot of functions and stuff like that, we're going to want to be able to infer summaries for functions such as the str copy that was on the previous slide. Okay, because this will be called at different call sites, and yeah. It's important to note that, as I mentioned, it was already known that tracking the length of string and the allocated size of buffer is quite important to get such results. But in the previous work by Nurit Dor and Xavier Lamijon, for example, the str copy was hard-coded in the semantic of the str copy function were hard-coded in the analyzer. Whereas here, we want to not only infer a summary for this function, but also be able to reuse it for further analysis. So, performing a modular analysis on this function yields more difficulties because we have to know where do pointers point to and what are the possible aliasing schemes that we will get. So, in order to present all this, as you have seen on the first slide, you want to tackle some kind of low-level subset of C. In order to not start the abstraction from scratch, we're going to build our analysis on the already existing cell abstract domain. Okay, and on top of this analysis, we're going to start putting higher-level abstractions that will be able to describe, for example, string lengths and string allocated size. And on top of that, we're going to present how we try to take this analysis and transform it into a modular analysis that was able to infer some summaries for functions. So here is the example of the language we want to handle. So what is important to note here is that there are array, union type, structure type, strings, which is some high-level consideration, but we also have dynamic allocation, pointer arithmetics, and you can do basically any typecasting you want. Okay, so in order to handle this thing, we're going to start by the cell abstract domain. So as you have seen, this is low-level C, therefore a good memory representation would be to have a byte-level memory representation. However, we want to be able to infer some more interesting numerical relation than those that can be described by the byte-level memory representation. Therefore, we are going to rely on the cell abstraction, which goal is to regroup some adjacent bytes and to put them into what is called a cell, which is basically just a portion of the memory. Therefore, it's denoted by its base variable, its offset, and the type of the value it's containing. So here you have a quick example of an example of cell memory representation for the above byte-level memory representation. Now, this is able to tackle the numerical values, but what about pointers? So pointers will be represented as for a numerical value, meaning that we will have cells of type pointer, and the numerical value that we associate to such cells will denote their offset. And now we just have to be able to represent the base variables I can point to. And we do this by just adding a map from the subset of cells of type pointer to a set of variable which towards which they can point. Okay, so a little example of how this works. So here on the left, you have the declaration of some integer A, of some unsigned integer A. And it is set to 1. Then you have the declaration of a pointer towards A. And so you can see what happens on the right is that we first add, because the set of cells is dynamic, so we start by adding the cell we need to for the rest of the analysis. So we add the cell placed in A out of set 0 and of type unsigned integer, and we map its value to 1. And when we define the we declare the pointer and define it, we add the pointer cell, map its value to 0 because its offset as a pointer is 0, and add to the mapping that it points towards the base variable A. Now, in order to abstract this, because for now we still have the function from cell to numerical values, we just replace this function by a numerical domain whose dimensions are cells. Okay. So two important points to note at this point is that the set of cells is dynamic. I've mentioned that. And in order to tackle dynamic memory allocation, because this was in our syntax, we will just use recency abstraction. Okay. So now we have defined the cell abstract domain, let's see how we build the string abstraction on top of this. Well, we assume that we have a static partitioning of the program variable into two sets, one of which is the set of the program variable that we consider to be strings and that we want to be handled by the string abstract domain. Okay, and for each of those program variables, we are going to assign two instrumentation variables that will be placed inside the numerical domain. So they are annotated with a little l and little a. Little a codes for the length of the string, so the index of the first null in the buffer, and a for the allocated size. So on the bottom here, you have another example. So we start by the definition of some string of size 3, and the definition of an integer, and some manipulation on the string. And what happens is you can see that we did not add the cell S0, S1, and S2. We just manipulated the instrumentation variable associated to S to record the fact that now the length is equal to 1 and its allocated size is 3. Okay. So now that we have defined this string abstract domain, you can see that we can choose between a representation of a string inside the cell domain or inside the string abstract domain. And there is obviously a Galois connection between the two. And so on the left here, you have a representation of the string at the bottom inside the cell abstract domain. You can see that it requires the use of this is a mistake. The last one should be S14. This requires the use of 15 cells that are themselves placed inside a numerical domain. But on the right, where you have the representation in the string abstract domain, this requires only the two variables. And so the two functions from cell and to cell that translates a string from the string domain to the cell domain are both computable and could be used for a more interesting dynamic partitioning of the cells of the string versus cells. Okay. So the operator on our abstract domain are quite simple because basically you just have to unify the set of strings on both sides and rely on the numerical domain. Once you have, of course, unified the set of cells as well. So in order to define the transformers on this abstract domain, it is important to note that we are developing our abstract domain inside the MOPSA framework, which is a framework that enables, that provides some dynamic expression transformation. And thanks to that, we only have to define the transformers on some canonical expressions or statements. And here, those two canonical expressions are basically just a read and a write. Yeah, from top to bottom, write and read. Another important point is the fact that in MOPSA you can just in MOPSA expressions are evaluated toward disjunction. This disjunction contains pairs of elements which are expression and abstract environment, and basically this means that for every pair, this is the evaluation of the expression in this abstract environment. Okay, so you can just partition and give back. So this makes the job quite simple, because if you want to perform a read now at some offset E, well, you just have to compare the offset with the length of the string and check that you are in the bound of the buffer. And so these are the four cases. First, if you are before the index of the first zero, then you are reading something that is not zero, so you yield back the range 1 to 155. If you are reading at the position of the first zero, then you read a zero. If you're reading after, you don't know anything except for the fact that it's a char, an inside char. Okay, so now that we have those four cases defined, the result of the evaluation is just applying, is just partitioning the state according to the tests, and then giving back the expression that is on the right here. Okay. When you want to perform a write, there are more cases, so I'm just going to show a few of them. But basically, either you're trying to write a zero before the first, the position of the first zero, then you know that you have to change the position of the first zero to the offset at which you're writing, or you might be writing a non-zero at the position of the first zero, then you have to forget the information about the length, but you know that it's the new value of the length is after the position of the offset. And keep in mind here that when I write that when L is equal to A, it means that there are no zero in the string. Yeah. And there is a case where you don't change anything because you're writing a non-zero at the position where you know that it was already a non-zero character. And now when you want to define the transformer, you iterate over all those cases, you apply the tests, you apply the transformation and the abstract element, and you join all of them. If you have an abstract element where you have some precise information, such as the length is 3 and the offset is 1, and you're writing a non-zero, then basically, all cases will be bottom except for the unchanged cases. Okay. So now let's go back to the introductory example. We start the analysis of this fragment of str copy with the assumption that p and q both point to the beginning of the string. We assume that there is some char in the string that contains the null character. And from that, we get the invariant that, well, the offset of P is equal to the offset of Q, and the length of the buffer towards which P points is greater than its offset. So basically, we know that for now, we have only written non-zero character. And basically, the what we get at the end, thanks to this invariant, is that the length of both strings is are equal. Now, let's see how we can try to infer modular summary, how we can try to infer summary from that. So if in order to infer some, if we try to do a bottom-up analysis with C low level or with pointers, you have basically a choice to make, because either you will have to perform the analysis for every aliasing schemes, which could result in an exponential blow-up, or you make no assumption whatsoever about the aliasings, and then you you lose a lot of precision. So in order to not have this choice, we decided to go with a top-down analysis so as to have call site information. And in a classical top-down analysis, the function calls are inline. Therefore, here, we are going to try to use the first few function body analysis to infer a summary on this function, and replace the further function body analysis by the use of a summary. So what kind of summary do we want to use, or what shape should they have? Well, if you a classical one would be to keep a list of input-output relation, But if you use just input-output relation, then basically you are not able to express the semantic of the incrementation, precise semantic for the incrementation function on the left here. Therefore, we use a classical technique of using relational domain containing prime and non-prime variable, and seeing it as a function from the set of prime variable to a not prime variable. And that's what the semantic brackets mean here, that we see it as a function. And so, how do we do that in practice? Well, we will have summaries that will be basically a set of filters relation. Instead, yeah, and a relation is something that is a mapping from abstract element to abstract element, not just an abstract element. And fi is basically just preconditions, so they are abstract elements. And satisfying a precondition is just being lower than being contained in the abstract element. So when we encounter a function call, either, and it's the good case, you can find some filters that you satisfy, then you can rely on the relation, or you cannot find a filter that you satisfy, and then you just have to create a new one if the number of summary is low enough, or you can just, if the number of summary is too high, we are gonna try to choose some summary according to some criteria, for example, of how different S is from Fi here. And once we have chosen one good candidate, we widen the candidate with S and start a new analysis from this state that we obtain and store the and replace the old relation by this new one. Okay. So now an example. Let's assume that we have an incrementation function. This is not the same as before. Now it takes a pointer as argument and increment the value that it's pointing to. And let's assume that it's called, for example, at two different code location, program point location. And that's here on the right, you have some state at call site. Now, at first glance, they are not alike. And this is a problem because we would like the analysis of the first the analysis to reuse the analysis that we did at the blue point to be used at the red point. So there are some transformations that we are going to make on this abstract state, and basically they amount to framing. So we remove useless information, so unreachable blocks for now. For now, we just remove unreachable block, and then we do universal quantification on some of the memory blocks. For example, here the alpha is a symbolic cell. Now, once it's done, we are going to start some what I called before a relational analysis. And basically, this just means that you add prime variable to the numerical component and launch the analysis. You get a new state, and this will form a new relation. So basically, a relation is some shape that is the part that on which you didn't manage to build relation. There is a shape for the input, a shape for the output, and some relational part in the middle that relates the inputs with the output. So this is everything that you manage to, upon which you manage to build an interesting relation. So for this example, this is numerical domain. Here you can see that for the incrementation function, what was inferred at the first call site was that the value of contained by in the numerical cell that is pointed to by x at the end was increased by 1 during the evaluation of the function. And this summary can be reused for the analysis of the red program point here. Okay? So a more interesting example. This is the strcat function. Under some condition, we performed the analysis of this function, and we inferred the following summary for the function. And this summary is stating that I did not put the shape part, only the numerical part. And this states that the length of the string that is pointed to by dest, at the end is the sum of the length at the beginning, so which is what we wanted to get. Okay, so a few words on implementation. So this was implemented in the MOBSA framework, as I have mentioned, which is a new framework under construction for the development of static analyzers that are defined by abstract interpretation. It is written in OCaml and supports for now a subset of C and Python. The tests that we did are not really extensive, but we focused on comparison with previous works. And here are two examples. So first, this was taken from works by Xavier Alamijon that he did on string. And he mentioned in this work that this was one of the hardest code snippets that they had to analyze, because if you watch what is happening, basically a lot of things, and mainly the fact that strings are placed inside a struct, which are themselves placed inside the matrix, and you manipulate them by pointer manipulation, and you then call the strcopy function on them. And for us, this was not a big deal at all, because mainly it was handled by the cell abstract domain that was doing all the job behind. So the string domain was able to work just thanks to the fact that it was built over an existing domain that was able to handle low-level C features. There were no false positive, and the error at line 15 was found. And so this example was taken from a work by Nurit Dor. This is an insert long function, and basically it just inserts a string of size 6 inside a global variable buff that is pointed to by the CP argument here. So you can see that once again this is manipulating a lot of pointers, and we were able not only to successfully analyze the function and prove the absence of error, but also to infer a modular relation on the function, which says that the length of the buffer was increased by 6 during the when it's called. Okay, so a few words of conclusion. The two main contributions of this work were the development of a low-level C static analyzer that is able to perform higher-level abstractions, and the lifting of this analyzer to a precise modular framework that is based on input-output relation, partitioning, and input generalizations. So there is a lot of work that remains to be done. As you have seen, we do not have a lot of benchmarks yet. So this is the first point. We would like to be able to have a better modularity regarding pointer aliasings and memory blocks, because these were the parts that were in the symbolic part of the relation earlier. And we also would like to be able to improve the partitioning and the framing, and those two would be improved greatly by some pre-analysis on which we are currently working. And finally, improving the relations between the string and cell abstract domain, because as I mentioned, for now, there is a static partition for the program variable, but we already built the two functions from cell and to cell to move one from the other. So we hope that we could be able to have an interesting dynamic partitioning or some reduced product. Thanks.
Questions? There's a question down there. Peter?
I'm wondering how you know when to make an error report. Could you go to slide 21?
Yes.
Like there, I think if CP is null, then there is an error.
No, of course. Oh, yeah. This was analyzed under some conditions.
Right.
Yes.
Who gives the conditions? Does the human or does the analyzer find
this? It was because this was called by some other function, and we used this. Oh, sorry, yes. Okay. There should be a main somewhere. And basically we use some of the condition from the code that this was taken from. Because, yeah, of course, without any hypothesis, there were errors and they were found.
Okay. Any other questions? So for the future work, some more interest, more substantial benchmarks, something, have you thought about going into look on some security related problems?
No.
Maybe I think that would be challenging.
No, for now we us interesting in the fact that this helps the scaling, and so basic errors for now.
Patrick?
The union, it's handled by the cell abstract domain. In the language?
No, in the abstract domain.
Yeah.
When you have a union.
A join?
No, a union. C union.
Yeah, this is handled by the cell abstract domain. Okay. We all those considerations are given to an underlying level. Okay. We just wanted to show that we were able to build some higher level abstraction on top of some low level feature of C.
Nicolas?
What prevents you from using the same thing in a pure bottom-up approach?
Oh,
the expression of summaries or?
No. This is just that we are guided a lot by call site informations. Yeah.
Okay. If no other questions, thank you.
No, you can do bottom-up. It's just that on the examples we wanted to tackle first, there would have been an exponential blow-up due to pointer aliasings. So thank you.